morning and welcome to our latest service for St John's Church in Bellingdon. It's 28th of February. As we record this, it's a bright sunny morning, if a bit cold, and I hope it is on Sunday when this goes out as well. We're to our second Sunday in Lent, and our focus from our readings is about the cost of our salvation, the price paid by Jesus and God the Father. It's great to be able to share with you once again, and we do hope that you're enjoying these services and finding them beneficial. As we begin, our words of preparation. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. So we're going to come to our first hymn for today. Which is, the words may be slightly less familiar, but the tune will be well known to you. God is here as we, his people, meet to offer praise and prayer. So let's join in singing this together. So we come, as usual, to our time of confession. We begin with those words which we hear most weeks. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And so we pray together. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. So with that promise recorded by the Apostle John, that if we confess our sins, then God is faithful and just and will forgive us those sins, we can pray. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to come to our psalm for today, which is part of Psalm 49. We're going to read together verses 5 through to 15. Words which echo our readings, which we'll hear in a few minutes, as they speak of God paying the ransom, the only one who could pay that ransom for mankind. So let's say this together. Psalm 49, beginning to read at verse 5. Why should I fear when evil days come, when wicked deceivers surround me, those who trust in their wealth and boast in their great riches? No one can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for them. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough, so that they should live on forever and not see decay. For all can see that the wise die, that the foolish and the senseless also perish, leaving their wealth to others. Their tombs will remain their houses forever, their dwellings for endless generations, though they have named lands after themselves. People, despite their wealth, do not endure. They are like beasts that perish. This is the fate of those who trust in themselves and of their followers who approve their sayings. They are like sheep and are destined to die. Death will be their shepherd, but the upright will prevail over them in the morning. Their forms will decay in the grave, far from their princely mansions. But God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And I'd like to welcome Chris Emery, who's going to bring us our two readings this week. The first one from Romans chapter 4, and then from Mark chapter 8. And then I'll say a few words about the passage, particularly from Mark chapter 8. But first, let's listen to Chris as he brings our reading.
Our first reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 4, starting at verse 13 and reading through to the end of the chapter. It was not through law that Abram and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. For if those who live by law are heirs, faith has no value and the promise is worthless, because law brings wrath, and where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offering, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham. He is father of us all, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He is our Father in the sight of God, in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became father of many nations. Just as it has been said to him, so shall your offering be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words "it was credited to him" were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, he was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Gospel reading comes from St. Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, starting to read from verse 31 to the end of the chapter. Jesus then began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of man." Then he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it if a man, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? And what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you very much to Chris for bringing our reading from Mark's Gospel. And we're just going to spend a few minutes looking at these verses. I'm sure you're familiar with Jerusalem. You may even have followed the Via Dolorosa. Others of you will be familiar with the music Olivet to Calvary by John Henry Maunder. Whether in words or music or physical steps, the route that Jesus took to his death brings us our own personal way to the cross, a way that sets us apart as Christians. It's a route that takes us each year from Lent to Palm Sunday to Maundy Thursday on to Good Friday and the glories of Easter morning. Jesus' path with all its highs and lows brings to our minds the elation and the suffering he went through and reminds us of the ups and downs of our own lives. Our way starts back at the midpoint in Mark's Gospel, the passage we touched on 2 weeks ago as we looked at the Transfiguration, looked at the events that caused so much confusion in the minds of the disciples. Confusion that then started to clear on the mountaintop where God spoke to them, echoing the words that were spoken at Jesus' baptism. And this confusion centered around what sort of Messiah Jesus was going to be. Our passage from Mark is very structured. It opens with Jesus' road to the cross, with his prediction and Peter's denial. And then in the verses 34 to 38, he moves out onto the road from the cross with Jesus' prediction for what it means to us and the consequences of our denial of him. This week, we'll start with Jesus' way to the cross and then look at our own road to the cross. But in both parts, we will look at prediction and denial, then draw our thoughts together at the end. Our passage begins with Jesus teaching the disciples about the future and in particular his future and how it's going to bring salvation to all mankind. We saw a couple of weeks ago that the disciples' expectation for the Messiah is very different from God's plan. We saw that they were almost certainly expecting someone like King David, who would sort out the problems and establish a new kingdom and a new age, and who would free his people physically from their oppressors, the Romans. But God had a different plan. Jesus, the Messiah, God's anointed, is to save people from themselves, to save them from spiritual oppression brought about by sin and all the problems that grow from sinfulness. And Jesus tells the disciples he must suffer many things. He must be rejected by those in authority, the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, rejected by those whose studies should have given them more insight, who should have seen the clues in the book of the prophet Isaiah, telling of a suffering servant, a lamb being led to the slaughter. Jesus tells them that suffering and rejection is not enough, and that he must be killed before rising again 3 days later. Jesus teaches them that God's way, the way that he, Jesus, must follow, is the way that leads to the cross and to triumph over death, victory over the ultimate foe, not just over the earthly powers of Rome. As we look on to verses 32 and 33, we have Peter's denial. But we can guess that Peter, the more outspoken and impetuous of the disciples, was putting into words what they were all thinking. No, this must not happen. This is not what we're expecting. And so Jesus tells Peter to get behind me, Satan. Jesus isn't seeing Peter as the devil, but he uses Satan as Mark used it in last week's reading about the temptations, where Satan means God's adversary. Peter is challenging God's plan. Jesus warns the disciples they do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Their place is to follow and to understand, not to challenge and look for God in their own plans. It is the way not of the cross, but of mankind they risk following. So what of our road? The road that leads from the cross to the promised future. In these verses 34 through to 38, Jesus has widened his audience to include the crowd. And in doing so, addresses all who listen, and hopefully that includes us. And Jesus tells them plainly that to follow after him will have a cost. Following him will mean taking up his cross, being willing to put aside their own wants, being prepared to submit and accept God's plan, just as Jesus is committed to following God's plan, even though it means suffering, rejection, and death. As we saw a moment ago, we must have in mind the things of God, not the things of man. Then Jesus expands his comments in the closing verses 35 to 37, stressing that nothing is more important than wholeheartedly following him on the way of the cross, a way that brings eternal life, even if our earthly life is given up for the gospel, a way that values the soul, values eternal life more than all the wealth of the world. As we heard in our psalm, nothing the world has can be given to buy eternal life. Only Jesus, the way to the cross and our road beyond, can bring this. We cannot buy or earn our place in heaven. Only Jesus can pay that price, and God is willing to pay that on our behalf. Then in the final verse 38, it speaks again of denial, mirroring Peter's denial in verse 32. But this time it is Jesus telling of the consequences of denial with a clear and rather disturbing statement. If we're ashamed of Jesus, of the good news, then he'll be ashamed of us when he comes in judgment at the end of time. We must be true to Jesus, true to his word, true to the way of the cross, true to the need to follow, true to the way we need to follow in the present world on our way to the new heaven and new earth. So we'll finish there for this week. Jesus' road took him to the cross, to his death and resurrection. And though through his death and resurrection we can move on beyond the cross, we must always be willing to look back to the cross, to to venture back to its foot with our worries and our burdens, our sorrows and our joys. Jesus is very definite and clear about the price he'll pay. He's equally clear about what is required of us. And he's clear that this may well mean that we need to give before we receive his welcome at the end of time. The passage is clear. We must be willing to take up our crosses and follow Jesus, even to the length of suffering for him. We must never sell our souls, no matter how much we're offered. We must never be ashamed of standing up and speaking out for Jesus, sure in the knowledge that if we are true to him, he will be true to us now and at the end of time. Amen. So we're going to come to our second hymn for today now. It's King of Kings, Majesty. So we can either listen to this or just join in if we want to. So let's have our second hymn. So we come now to our time of prayer, and we begin with the Lord's Prayer. So we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. And our collect for the second Sunday of Lent. Almighty God, by the prayer and discipline of Lent, may we enter into the mystery of Christ's suffering, and by following in his way, come to share in his glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And our morning collect. Almighty and everlasting God, We thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our doings and guide us to do always what is righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now I'm pleased to welcome Linda, who's going to lead our intercessions today.
Let us pray. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. O God of love, make us more thankful for all the boundless mercies of our daily life. Forgive us that we are so often ungrateful, complaining, and discontented, taking for granted your greatest gifts, the blessings of health, the comforts of home and family, the joys of friendship, and the beauty of the world around us. Teach us day by day to number our blessings and to receive each of them as from our Father's hand, and fill our lives with gratitude and our lips with praise. Amen. A prayer for this time of Lent. Lord Jesus, we turn with confidence to you, knowing that you were tempted in all respects as we are, yet without sin. Give us your help that we may obtain victory over our temptations. We are ashamed that we have such little power in our lives, and that we often fall at the same old hurdles. Teach us to remember the promise that those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. May we wait and be made strong. We ask it in your name and for your sake. Amen. We thank you, Father, for the gift of composers, musicians and singers, for music which calms our fears, lifts our hearts, speaks to our souls, and takes us beyond words into the presence of your joy. At this time, when we have been unable to worship in our own church, we are grateful, Lord, for the wonderful singing and clear voices of St. Martin's Choir. They have greatly enriched our services and brought us much pleasure. We thank you, Lord, for the skill and dedication of these singers. Amen. And then a prayer for the coming Fair Trade fortnight. Lord God, in the fields of the poor, even when abundant fruits ripen, injustice sweeps them away and families go hungry. Help us to share the fruits of your bounty so that all your family may benefit from your gracious gifts. Dear Lord, we ask your blessing on all who are involved with fair trade. Grant them wisdom and discernment as they make decisions about how to use the benefits of fair trade. The people who transport fair trade goods to market, that they might be treated fairly. May those who import and retail fair trade goods have a genuine commitment to fairer trade for all. And all of us who shop where fair trade goods are for sale, grant us an understanding of the impact of our choices. Amen. We thank you, Lord, for the church of which we are members, and pray for your blessing on all who share with us in its life and worship. Help us to take our eyes off ourselves and turn them on those outside, always remembering that the Church of Christ exists not for itself, but for the sake of others, and to spread far and wide the good news of his salvation. through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As the World Day of Prayer approaches, we give thanks for all volunteers who have worked hard preparing for this event and overcoming the obstacles of online presentations. We pray for all those taking part this special day, for friendship and fellowship. And we pray for the people of Vanuatu, that they would feel the wave of prayer washing over them. Amen. Dear Lord, we pray for all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit at this time, or feeling particularly low and miserable due to isolation. We bring before you, Lord, the Duke of Edinburgh, having rest and care in hospital. The Queen and all the royal family who are anxiously awaiting news that the Duke is well enough to return home. Now, in the quietness of our hearts, we bring before you, Lord, all those known to us personally who need our prayers at this time. O God of love, we commend to your merciful care and healing grace those we have now remembered in our hearts. We ask you to do for them all that is best, according to their need, and according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And a final prayer. Father, give to us and all your people, in times of anxiety, serenity. In times of hardship, courage. In times of uncertainty, patience. And at all times, a quiet trust in your wisdom and love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
So thank you very much to Linda and to Chris for our readings and our intercessions today. And now we come to our third and final hymn, one by Graham Kendrick, a different recording this week. The price is paid, come let us enter in to all that Jesus died to make our own for every sin. So let's sing this together.
Thank you.
So we're coming now to the close of our service. Just looking ahead to, on Friday is the World Day of Prayer, and there'll be a YouTube video on this same channel. We'll try and send a link to you, but do look out for that, available on Friday morning from 10 o'clock, recorded here in St John's. And then next Sunday, I'm hoping to welcome Estelle from Christchurch, who is part of our training, will be bringing our sermon to us. We'll have a very slightly different format for the sermon, and we'll have an intro to the reading, and then the reading itself, and then the talk probably in two parts with a piece of music in between. But we hope that'll all go well, and we look forward to welcoming Estelle next week. So our closing prayer. May the Lord bless us and watch over us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look kindly on us and give us peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst us and remain with us always. Amen. So do take care during the week, and I hope you'll be able to join us again.